our citizens in our country. Then, of course, after my speech, actually, I can take some questions. But thank you, the panels, just the previous panels. The lot of encouraging words I heard from different panelists. Monem, you should ask me that you need a partner. The way you have placed it, that you need a partner, I am there to provide. Don't worry about that. So, lot of entrepreneurship ideas came up from what I heard from the panelists. And thank you again for arranging this kind of program. Thanks the organizers. And of course, thanks BIDA and SDG to invite me. I have written speech over here because I don't want to miss of the words what I want to do. Express myself, then of course, then I can go with the questions to answer. So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So we are gathered here to celebrate the success of Bangladesh. The reason behind is economic success. For me, don't go to the next slide, just put it, yes. Success is not a destination, but a journey. That's why the definition of success keeps changing. But for some time now, we have shifted our focus from project-based development to people-based development. Today I was planning to talk about how Bangladesh is redefining the success criteria of our power sector. How we went from ability to affordability and want to move towards quality. You see, here is just one picture of the power sector success. Just 7 years back, in 2009, 8 years back, there are only 46 power plants. Now it's about 130 and it's going on. Powering about 28.2 million people already. Every month we're connecting about 350,000 consumers. Installed capacity is more than 17,000 right now. Covered 90% of the people. And recent survey, we found out 86.9% people are satisfied with the uninterrupted power. You see, the power sector in Bangladesh has seen a notable improvement in recent years, no doubt. Completely winging on planning in a correct move. We started with quick power, and are now making a transition towards cheap power. Bangladesh, a highly dense populated country, has seen record number of connections in recent years. One company, IB, gives as much as what I've told you, 350,000 connections every month. So let's see what kind of investment we need in the future. Our plans are directly correlated with Bangladesh's economic ambitions. Being a developing country by 2041, to reach there, we have to target a lofty 10% GDP growth. And for that, we need around $82.5 billion in investment and produce around 60 gigawatts of power. Even 60 gigawatts is a conservative amount considering linear growth, we took it into account energy efficiency and efficient uses pattern. So far, we have got around $22 billion in funding. The prime coming from Japan, China, India, Singapore, Middle East, and Europe. We are now getting interest from US as well. As our market matures and the warm spreads. You see, what is happening back there in Bangladesh, how we plan for the future. The best case for Bangladesh, we decided after long analysis, we have thought of something like this for Bangladesh energy mix. Coal and gas for our base load, coal for its cheap power, gas for its clean power. A mix of domestic gas and LNG. Nuclear for its cheap power and learning curve. Important to know, even though Bangladesh has low radiation and a huge population, we have not shed away from renewable power. We want to increase our presence in cross-border too. And with Bangladesh playing a huge role in integrating Southeast Asia. You have already heard. You can see that in our master plan, we have kept coal, gas, renewable energy, cross-border. That means already we have been connected with the neighboring countries. And we have connected, we want to connect it with Nepal and Bhutan in a bigger way, taking the hydropowers in a bigger way. Also, we are encouraging ourselves to go further east to take power from China through Myanmar. Nuclear already there, constructing. We'll see within the next couple of years the nuclear power plant. And of course, some others from the renewable energy sources. So, you see the prime direction where Bangladesh is heading has been constantly changing. And like many nations in the world, we are asking ourselves, what is development? It is not for the people. GDP is good for measuring the speed of the economy. But it's a poor indicator to measure collective well-being. Research has shown that Human Development Index, which takes into account life expectancy index, education index, and gross national income, HDI has also shown to have a direct correlation with power production. I've shown three countries in example. You see, Canada, they consume about 14,000 kilowatt per hour. For the high HDI country, if you want to be, you must use about more than 5,000 kilowatt per hour. So they consume about more than 14,000. If you take the example of Turkey, middle income country like this, the HDI, the Turkey people actually consume about more than 2,500 kilowatt power. And if you take the low income countries like Nigeria, HDI, they still are under 1,200 kilowatt. So this actually relates about the HDI level, the Human Development Indexes, the power. More power you use, more HDI level increases. That is what actually now the power division has planned to do. Let me show you some curves to what has happened. You see, Bangladesh has achieved remarkable success in increasing the HDI for our people. Championing in reduction in child mortality rises, increase in primary educations, and however, an HDI value of 0.579 puts us youth at 139th among 181 countries. Still now, the more power we use, the more economic opportunities, more income, more kids sent to school, more kids born in hospital. Actually, this is the place where we want to go on 2041. An HDI value of developing nations. For that, we have to increase our power productions. You see, we consume, the last slide you see that 450 kilowatt hour per annum per person in our country. So if you increase the HDI, we need to consume at least 2000 kilowatt per person per annum. So there is a huge opportunity of generating power and huge opportunity of investment in the power sectors. So let me go in the this slide. What I call the public good and merit good. You see, economic development cannot be achieved with the government hang up on providing power all by themselves. The state exchequer already provides around 590 million. It's about 50 million taka subsidy to our main power offtaker, PDB. This is not sustainable in the long term. On the other hand, we have the challenges of enabling people. Almost 60% of the population uses our lifeline slabs, paying around 50 cents a month on power. But the Bangladeshi government does believe that in order to elevate ourselves to a developing country, we not only need to ensure the availability of power, but also the quality and reliability. And for that, we need the private sector's participation. And for that, we ensuring stable environment for investments. Already about 50% of the generations come from the public sectors, but we're moving fast into transmissions also. Sometimes within the next decade, in distribution too. Only then the power will be true merit good. What I wanted to mean that, it's not only does government will provide everything, the investments, all the theories what have happened last decades. We have changed our ideas in the government sectors. We are moving to a taking of the private sectors together. This is the one of the best examples, sectors in the power. The taking the private and public sectors together, hand to hand, to go and develop the merit good of the country. This is what I want to do. So of course there are challenges, big challenges. What are the challenges? Main thing is the financing challenges. What I told you earlier, $82 billion I'm looking for within the next 5 years. If I wanted to make my people use power more than 2,000 kilowatt power, and of course the technology adoptions. For reaching that place, we have a lot of challenges. But for today's setting, I would like to talk about two things. The first is planning. Bangladesh is a relatively new country, and for many years, we have relied on our domestic gas. Only in 2009, when the current government came to power, we made a power sector master plan with the help of JICA, which had a heavy focus on coal. In a later revision in 2016, we added LNG. We have kept provision of renewable, and we're very serious about it. But for our policies are a little conservative. There might come a time in the near future where the world is looking at free power and we're paying more expensive gas and dirty coal. I like the research in this area, and we would like to solve the challenges of coming up with prudent plan. Standing in what may be the most prestigious university in the world, I think we can talk about possible research collaboration for this kind of solutions. See, there are other challenges which we need to build our own capacity. In the heart of my target board is the blueprints. We want to build them, world-class blueprints. More professional, more updated, more technology-friendly. Then, of course, the sector professionals, financial planners, policy planners, economic planners. And outer periphery of my targeted board is the sector engineers, state-owned power companies. That should be developed. And what we are doing that, we have already started to building our own training institute and making it in the world-class institute. So our SDG has taken the initiative and I'm just following that. So what will be the emerging challenges I see in the future also? There might be a carbon tax because we are going for a coal in a bit of big way. Challenges to renewable escalations. Integration of data-driven strategies. We never had that before. And never thought about that. Implementing new but unproven technologies. You see, the new era comes new challenges. Just last month I was in Germany attending energy-wide conference. There, KW BAM came to me and saying that they don't want to finance a transmission line. They are supposed to be financed because it will be carrying power generated from coal. And their pressure back home. Sometime in the future, economics will say we don't want t-shirts which are made from coal power. Imposed carbon tax is a new challenge which personally scares me. How to accelerate renewable energy, possibly amend our land use policy, which forbids solar panels to be set up in agricultural lands. How to increase use of data in our decision makings. How to bring automation to the sectors. How to implement technology like smart grids, cashless payments. People are skeptical of technology. How to tackle the cyber threats for the future. So you can understand that in the power sector, just moving around generating power for the future, it's also facing a lot of challenges. And these challenges is sometimes new for our country, and the sector-wise also new for us. That is the thing actually we need to do. The more highly professional back there. To take the correct decisions at the correct time, and where this financial institution can be part with us to develop the power sector together. So my last slides, I go like that actually. Challenges always sound bleak. I would like to end on a happy note. You know, always feels good when people get behind you to solve a bunch of challenges. We have addressed all these challenges head on. And our administration, bureaucrats, and general people have faith in the power and energy sector of Bangladesh. Just 15 days from now on, LNG will flow for the first time in the history of Bangladesh. We are trying new models in solar systems. New technology is power sector data, efficient systems, IoT devices, cashless payments. The whole economy is coming forward to make the sectors a little bit better. I, as a minister, our government always looks forward to change chances for partnerships and where we can improve on ourselves. I'm standing in front of a stellar audience. I look forward to engage with you in discussion, of course. What you think about Bangladesh power energy sectors for the future. Thank you. Yes, it is.
So, how many questions?
10 questions, maybe.
Okay, the Honorable Minister is taking questions. Please come to the mic.
Please. Yes.
you have mentioned something about the data strategy. And what's your plan to integrate the global diaspora who are expert in data strategy to bring them back to Bangladesh to do some brain data?
Thank you. Fantastic. Any other questions? No more questions.
Hungry question.
Huh? People are hungry, that's right. That is one thing actually. I see in the last panels, there is a lot of opportunity for business people to turn into politics. So when I hear the speeches of our Munem, very excellent speeches what he made actually. So it happens. All, from all the sectors, you have people in the politics. And they've been good actually. Making the country more happier than before. So our Khaled journalist, do you have any question for me?
No, no, privately, I'll ask you all the questions privately. He and I went to the same school.
So I see that what I wanted to mention over here, actually, you said that it's not the generation we are planning on. It's not the transmission to provide power. Actually, we are changing the whole scenario of power. That is the main sectors, what we are trying to do for the futures. Power makes power. That should be the philosophy. And very directly to tell you that the data strategy, it was never been planned before. We never thought of the data can be the main improvement sectors to give, power sectors to plan ahead of everything. So we are preparing ourselves. We have hired the best of the consultants in the world. BCG is working with us. For human development, KPMG is working with us. A lot of big companies are working with us. So in investment-wise, GE has came up with a big plan to invest more of making 10,000 megawatt generating power from us. Siemens already, we have signed with Siemens. They also have came up with a more of investing about $12 billion in Bangladesh recently. Big companies from China, billions of dollars have been invested here. And we're making joint ventures with them, investing our own money. Why is that? Because we want to improve our people, the technology, and professionals. And also, we need huge equity participants. One of the panelists I heard that you mentioned that power sector is going to the public. Of course, it's not just making money. Government has never thought of making money. You see, I have explained in my slides that still about 55 million people are under lifeline. That means they pay less than 50 cents a month. Why is that? Because the government is determined, the Sheikh Hasina government, determined to improve the capacity of the people's living capacity, standard of living, everything, to give them a buffer time to improve themselves. So that is also where the power is related. So a lot of changes are happening. We're very much involved in the long-term planning of improving the livelihood of our people. Thank you. No more questions.
Everybody's hungry.
Just supplementing about the data strategy. When we started working on SDG planning, we find only 40% data we have. The rest 60% we don't have. Some are partial, some in some cases we have no data. Then we are looking into some of the data are old age, maybe 5, 10, 15 years old data we are using. So these are useless. Government has taken very serious steps on this. Earlier there was no data coordination activities. Very recently, just 2 months back, a data monitoring, correction, and implementing coordination committee has been formed under the Ministry of Statistics and Informatics. I believe that will help in acquiring data and also in power sector data. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. We're trying to automation most of the power plants. And of course, we have trying to improve our LLDC, that means the load dispatch centers, to give more of data so that we can take more decisions for the future, actually, for improving our service in the past. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.